just give me about 30 seconds of it, and we'll kind of see if we have anything there. I'm going to guess that you're looking at the corner of the dumpster right there.
I think so.
So probably not anything, but it's worth looking at always. Interesting piece. Yeah, give me another full minute or two of that.
I just moved.
Charles and Eliza had a son named Charles. They had a nephew named Charles. That's three Chucks, in case you guys were paying attention. I don't think that's a problem with this group. But that's exactly why we look for those secondary clues. In the event that somebody hears the name Charles, I need to know which one it is so I know how to address them. Three different people, guys. So again, try to treat your ghosts as people. So the son and the nephew were signers of the Constitution for South Carolina. That's a big deal for us. You know where you're at? All right, hit it. You got it. Nice and slow. Keep it
following
right
you.
The entire time.
I think that's just a bush. It's picking up on the bush.
Yeah, I get that.
Or, I don't know what that is, but...
I don't know what I should be doing with this on my own, so I'm gonna stick by you.
Now that I'm getting closer to it, it's not picking up anything, so...
It might have just been a weird perception thing.
This guy, so this thing will pick up on anything with leaves. Do not point the camera at anything with leaves, just because all leaves are in front of another leaf.
Yeah.
It's always gonna look like a hangman in the tree.
Fair enough.
This will also pick up on shadows on the ground.
Okay.
So it's not a dead person laying down, it's you.
Okay.
So just kind of keep that in mind. Keep it running for the entire time that we're in a space, just because if you hit the record button by the time you think you saw something,
right.
It's gone.
Yeah.
So just keep it running, give us lots of footage. We normally get about an hour to an hour and 20 minutes of footage from each camera,
okay.
So that kind of gives you an idea.
Awesome.
But yeah, lots of debunking with this camera.
Mm-hmm.
So you're basically the debunker. That's
cool.
What I love about it.
Awesome.
Thank you.
I know that the mansion being destroyed was a tragedy. What happened?
Where?
It's right over here a little while ago. Actually 2.6, my new threshold is 25.
Not really.
Thank you.
Maybe.
Hear what I'm supposed to do.
Okay.
So far, I like it. I don't know how it compares to the other.
It's more clear than the other two.
Okay. I'll
be honest with you. Like, I'm using this.
Yeah, it's nice. And it's easy to hold too. Honestly, I've had it.
I really wish they would put the elements of all three of these watches in
one thing.
And the recordable functionality is my favorite. Because a lot of times, if I'm in the space, I run two, one on fast, one on slow, and I just leave them in my pocket. I don't have to listen to them until later.
Yeah.
So that's the beauty of them. So that's why I love that one so much. That one, when I'm doing a live session, I use that one.
Probably.
Probably.
Yeah, I don't know. How are you doing, Sherry?
Good. That's an old church back there, isn't it?
Yeah. What you doing?
Yeah, booth, coins, festival.
Yeah. Weird.
No. No entertaining?
Not at that time. We're talking about
something other. Oh, that's true. Yeah, not like that.
Very
okay,
thing.
Yeah.
Good.
So, was Abraham Lincoln here at all? Yeah. Or John Wilkes Booth?
No. I know. My mind. Yeah. Where is...
He's probably over there.
Anyway, check on that.
All right.
And then I'll regroup with us back there. All
right. Awesome.
Did something happen to the garden?
Yeah.
anything?
I don't know.
What did you grow in your garden, Eliza? Did you grow flowers like azaleas?
Really? Okay. Granted, I don't know what I'm looking at, so.
Yeah, let's go ahead and hit the stop button. I sure as hell did. Who wants to take a stab who the president was? That was the pallbearer at the funeral. Now that you know what year it was. 1793. Where's my history books? I know there's at least one of you.
Luther Washington.
Okay. Any other guesses? Are you doing that? How? Did you just go up based off the year?
Oh, he's just.
You just.
Yeah.
I don't know. All right.
Is he smart? So, years up. And let me see it for a second. Alright, so this is Philadelphia Alley. Brother Tourist Post Media will do exactly what we just did. We can just split the seas, we're all gathered to one side. In the event for the camera, just so you guys know, which, you know, other tourists coming through here, they'll either come through that ivy wall right there, because there's another set of stairs, or we're coming the same way that we did. I cannot take you all the way through here. I've been kicked out of this location too. We're going to talk about it because it's funny. and I'll tell you what. But just so the cameras know, in the event another tourist passing by, just point your camera downwards, we'll all understand. Now, this is Philadelphia Alley. It used to be called Jeweler's Alley. This is where some of the duels used to occur for the city of Charleston. Every ghost tour comes down here. All 339 ghost tours in Charleston, they all come here to stay. I was actually going to take this out of my route because every ghost tour comes down here. This tour is probably going to come all the way down to this as well. Just because I like to take you guys to weird spots. But again, like I said, this guy likes to fall in the house now. Fridays and Saturdays, it's a couple of positives of every ghost tour.
Two sus.
Oh, you're good, you're good. How are you?
Good. You?
Good.
I'm loving the weather.
We're good. Yeah. By the way, thank you for not picking the most humid night that we've had in the past 2 weeks. I greatly appreciate that.
Three apps. We used it on our ghost tour.
Where was I? Philadelphia Alley, the Jeweler's Alley, right? And then all the ghost tours come down here. Again, the guy followed me. Let's get into it. I'm going to tell you the same story that every ghost tour tells you, but I'm going to give you a few extra details because you're ghost hunting. You're not on a campfire marshmallow like those guys. Here's how it goes. The doctor moves down here from Rhode Island. So Julian's going to be looking for those letters R-I on her little Ouija board device. She already knew, about it on the way here because I told her. So R-I is the first set of initials. But the doctor moves down here. His name is Dr. Joseph Brown Ladd. Say his name slowly because if you guys hear the song Brown Eyed Girl while we're here, it's not coincidence. It's part of his name. We get it all the time. So, anyway, Doc moves down here because he's supposed to get married to his fiancée, Amanda. Amanda just inherited a lot of money from her dead parents, and she has an attorney helping her out with this cash flow that she just got. The attorney thinks that Dr. Ladd is just after Amanda's money, so he tells Amanda to get rid of that doctor. He moves down here to Charleston to prove that he's not after her money. He's going to start his medical practice here. On his way into town, he had a coachman set him up to be robbed and killed. It's like having a really bad Uber driver today. You guys get the point on that, right? Gotta leave a lot of younger folks in here sometimes. They don't know what a coachman is. But anyway, Doug's not having a point for having explained a lot of stuff. But anyway, somebody was walking by and seeing what was about to happen between the coachman and the newcomer. The person walking by was named Ralph Isaacs. Do those initials sound familiar? Right, exactly. Rhode Island. So, I was getting the letters R-I all the time on a regular spirit box, the one that Jeff is using, so I bought the one that Julian's using. This little device to kind of verify who it belongs to. It belongs to Ralph. I've gotten it about 7 times, but only when I bring up Ralph's name. Back to Ralph. He tells Doc, I know this guy, the coachman. He's going to try to kill you. Come with me. I got friends at 59 Church Street. You can rent a room from them, and you'll be safe and good to go. The Doc took him up on the offer, and the two gentlemen became friends. The longer the doctor stays here in Charleston, the more money he's making. He's proving his point. He's not after Amanda's money. He's making his own. She gets wind of this, and she's moving down so they can be married. Dr. Ladd became known as the Whistling Doctor. This is the reason I hate the damn story. It's a giant cliche. Every haunted city you will ever visit is going to have a cliche whistling ghost. We all have one. This one just happens to be a doctor. So why are we in Blue Valley? Here's, let's get into that. Doc and Ralph put some plays together. They can't sit next to each other because the doctor makes more money. That's the hierarchy of Charleston. He gets better seats. So on the way home from St. Richard III, they are arguing over the new actress they just saw. Doc thought she was great. Ralph didn't. The argument turns into Ralph insulting the doctor's fiance back home in Rhode Island. It got really ugly between the two of them, and they went their separate ways. But Ralph went to his friends at the newspaper and placed an ad telling the whole city of Charleston what he thinks of the doctor. Kind of a, you're a disgrace to society kind of bullshit. Doc saw this ad, but rebutted with, let's go to Euler Valley. We're going to settle this once and for all. Keep in mind that this argument started over an actress. I just like to point that out. A woman neither of these gentlemen actually knew. They came down here, back to back, took their 10 paces, they turned, Doc pointed his gun in the air. He shot his one shot. He did not want to kill his friend. He just needed the courage to show up. But Ralph has one bullet in his gun and he puts it in the kneecap on the doctor. Doc didn't die. Ralph proved his point. He's still pissed off. He's not willing to forgive. Friends pick up Doc and take him home to 59 Church Street. He dies 10 days later, November 2nd, 1786, after refusing medical treatment. Two things about that last statement. It's 1786. Gunshot wounds were a lot different back then than what we know of a gunshot wound now. Secondly, he is a doctor. He probably just tried to bleed it out, but he failed because he thought he had lead poisoning, but he failed because he died 10 days later. Every ghost story tells you to listen to the whistle glided down here. We have 3 cameras running plus my voice recorder. If we're going to capture a disembodied whistle, more than likely coming off of one of those 4 devices. I don't know how far they're coming down. Next day was the 28th. of November. I called my partner I had at the time, and I told him what happened. He laughed at me like my daughter did. He said, dude, you're only allowed to go down halfway. That's the cutoff point because it's considered residential after that. You're going to have to reroute your group. Your lawn sold out again for Black Friday. I'm still new at this. I got to wing it. I told my group, I don't believe in the next story because I'm into vampires, not pirates. I would normally tell you the pirate story next, but that's the other place I've been picked out of. We're not talking about that tonight. But before we left the space, somebody with a spirit box heard the name Anne. I didn't tell them which pirate we were going to be investigating. The female pirate, Anne Bonnie. So I'm like, okay, maybe we'll get something. I took him around the corner, told him I didn't know about pirates in Charleston. Not much, by the way. A few hours of research only. Somebody else with a spirit box heard the number 300. I wrote it down. I did the research. We were there November 28th of 2020. Anne Bonnie's trial for piracy, November 28th of 17. We were there on the exact 300th anniversary of the pirate trial. I normally get the, that's pretty cool. I was pissed off. Master's degree in creative writing. Whenever I'm doing anything, especially stuff paranormal where I have to research, I need, like, facts and data. Pirate stories come from pirate lore. That was written 100 years after the alleged golden age of piracy. And I say alleged because there's really no full account of it. So that's a problem for me. So whenever you guys are finding things relevant to piracy, especially Anne Bonnie, that's a shit ton of books I gotta read. And it took me 4 years to get us up to the story point where I was at with that location, and then they started monitoring the location for other tourists to not go there. And other tourists weren't going there to talk about pirates and Anne Bonnie. They were going there to talk about the Powder magazine, because that's what we were doing next to. So I can't take you guys there tonight. Instead, we're going to be using Madison's camera for the apparition experiment. I will tell you the history of what this apparition is about, and what every other ghost tour would tell their groups, and we're hopefully going to capture things we normally wouldn't be able to see with our own eyes, which is an apparition. So the story is a little on the darker side, so it's going to get darker than Dr. Live, but I want you to keep in mind that Dr. Live will follow us for the remainder of the evening. When you leave this space, assuming you can get unmuted, but when we reach the group, obviously mute back up again, just show some respect to them if they're not looking at us a little too weird. Spirit boxes, Jeff, listen. As I'm going around the corner, talk to me about like what we've seen so far. What other words have you gotten that you wanted to talk about? Anything specific?
Screw. Hold, surprise.
Okay. So she didn't have anything else before that. Any numbers I need to know about from the millimeters, trash field meter, Doug, anything?
No, earlier.
Yes,
it's higher.
Yeah,
I was going to say the same thing. I see
you kind of loading it lower. Yeah, the highest it would go is like 3.9.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'll take that 9.
That's why I was like, well, what the crap? That's why I was thinking maybe kids or something. Like, the lower you were going, then I was like,
it also depends on what type of stone and brick you're dealing with. So some of those stones that are behind you, Jessica, is probably going to hold on to a little bit of EMF. So certain stones will give off EMF on its own.
Yeah.
And the reason why we go to 2.5 directly is because the Earth actually gives off up to 1.1.
Gotcha.
Because, again, the Earth is a giant rock.
Yeah.
So we kind of have to look at those certain things. I used to take you guys to an alley where the stones that were like make up the cobblestones of it are not supposed to emit EMF, but we would get crazy readings out of them on certain nights only. So it was like a rotating pattern. It was almost like a stone tape theory, but it was only, I guess, active like every 6 to 8 weeks. So like weeks 1 through 7 weren't always the most best tour for that night. So I just took it out of my rep. I changed this up all the time. Anything else that I need to know about before we leave the space? Did you get anything? Nothing at all?
No.
All right. Yeah, let's go cut through that tour and invade this one. So, every ghost tour stops here. This is normally their grand finale because there's something to see. So let me kind of explain why they stop here. It's their one show and tell. My show and tell is in your hands with a bunch of blinky lights. Now, the sign right in front of the web, I believe, actually reads, there's no ghost here, but the Holy Ghost.
Did you see that?
They don't want people like me with cameras like what Madison's using to try to recapture what occurred here. Here's what occurred here. It's a very short one. 1888, a young lady died by the name of Sue Howard Harding. Somebody tell me what her initials are. What do they spell out?
S-H-H.
What does that spell out?
Shh.
Exactly. It's very cheesy, it's campy, but we've seen it on the Ouija board device and we've seen it on your wordless device. So take that for what it's worth. Sue dies 6 days after her stillborn child. Very sad story. 99 years later, exactly, June 16th of 1987, a local photographer named Harry Reynolds is taking pictures of all of our cemeteries. He captures a full apparition in one of his photographs. Keep in mind, it is 1987. He does not have the technology that we have today. He has to send it over to Kodak. For the younger crowd, that's where we send our pictures so we can hold them. Yes, that's a good joke on the rest of us. Bless you.
Thank you.
So, Kodak can confirm the camera that he took it on, of what he said, and that the picture was not altered. So now we have this beautiful apparition, and it is
touch it.
Pregnant females are said to not have a good pregnancy based off the gist of the story of it being a stillborn child. You guys can see why I don't always like this story. So I will show you, I will zoom in on the apparition so you guys can all see it. And by the way, I don't want to be the guy where somebody had a great honeymoon and 9 months later I cursed your damn family. So try not to play around. Let me zoom in on it for you, because again, I'm the one handling it every single day. A lot of people like to try to joke around, like, let me zoom in. I'm like, no, get the hell off my tablet. yeah, I'm a jerk like that sometimes. Alright, so if you guys want to cuddle around or circle around, or if you guys want me to go around the room, that's perfectly fine too. So here's your full picture that you took. Your apparition is right here. You're looking at a woman praying over her own grave with a baby basket next to her. I want you guys to also remember what I told you about baby George Pinkney over there, where the baby might be buried with mom. I could find no burial records for this child, nor a name. So again, I never thought the child was born, you know, stillborn. But it doesn't mean that they wouldn't have buried him with mom. Because again, she died 6 days later. So, her grave, for all the people holding cameras right now, you guys see the cross headstone off in the distance? Grave is to the left, and one more row back. We were actually closer to her when we were back in the alley, so just kind of keep that in mind. But this is the only visual that we can get. So, we are going to spare boxes if you have one. Start listening in. Let's get those, you know, obviously get you unmuted, Sue, and then headphones on the other two. Let's get you guys listening. So, Jeff, did you hear anything along the way here?
Yeah, I heard Lost Cause, Wrong Way, Less Fortunate, Never Again. These are the only things that I've heard that like made sense. I could make out.
Right. Well, again, it's all about what you can make out.
Yeah.
That's really what it's about. I'm gonna wait down a little bit more, so I'll repeat it again in a minute.
Oh,
yeah. Oh, good.
I like it. Good. Lost Cause.
Yeah, Wrong Way, Lost Cause, Less Fortunate, Never Again. Just since we've been saved and still here, every once in a while, we're just...
I'm going to put a question mark next to
yeah.
Just because, I am going to take a 3.2, just because the length right here is probably going to give, like, closer to a 7 or 8.
Yeah.
Just kind of get that. I did. Why is it?
You hear that, please? Go.
He's talking to the weed boy.
Sorry. I heard go.
We're not leaving.
My husband and I both heard go. I don't know, not go like scary go, but.
Go in?
Sure. I was just curious what was there.
Who's got the key?
This one.
I give this like another minute, because again, every tour comes up here. So I try not to take up too much time. And what I'll do is I'll move this down by the gate over there, and I'll explain our last two stops, because it's completely different than what we've been doing. What's the relationship from each person?
So,
who belongs to who?
So Susan and I are sisters.
Okay.
And
I heard baby boy.
No. This is my son and his girlfriend's Ian. And then the rest of everyone are Sue's friends and very close.
mine keeps spiking too high and it makes me anxious. It spiked to the 50s like 3 times and no one else has gotten anything.
And stop those cams. I think we got enough staring footage and it's done again. They're gonna be really weird. Sometimes people walk drive by and holler if you want to turn your camera. Don't. Somebody did that a couple weeks ago and they were literally filming a party bus. Like I'm like, stop filming them. Like they don't know they're gonna be posted on YouTube by morning. So, yeah, it's kind of a crazy thing. So this is as close as I can get it, like I said. Two more blocks down is where this murder actually occurred, November 1st of 1933. Here's what happened. A lady fell to the ground and started screaming in pain. A man hit me. I know I'm going to die. She's with a friend. It's in the middle of the afternoon, and everybody's a gentleman back then. Somebody driving by had seen a woman on the ground and stopped to help her. Well, he can't figure out what's going on with her either, so he actually helps her into his car and drives her to the hospital. That's where MUSC sits now, but it was called St. Roper's back then. It's called a few St. Roper's hospitals around town. Anyway, she gets down there. There's a doctor. The doctor's name is Dr. James Avery Finger. It's a silly name, but we've gotten all three parts of his name while we've been here, all in the same evening. The doc can't find what's going on with her either. Again, same repetitive thing she's saying, a man hit me, I know I'm gonna die. Guess what? She did, right on his table. And he didn't know what happened to her. Her name was Mary Ravenel. If you went over to Mount Pleasant and back again, you went over that giant bridge to get back into downtown Charleston. That's the Ravenel Bridge. This is a very prominent name here in Charleston. If you watch Southern Charm, there is the Ravenel family as a character on that show, kind of giving another perspective. I will make a few tags for the audio piece. We have a giant group of girls behind Webb, so they're going to be chatterboxing it up. I just want to make sure I don't capture that as a ghost. And Ben's chuckling at me because he knew exactly where I was going with that. Now, moving on. She did die, and the doc decides to send her over to the coroner and autopsy for him to figure out what actually happened to her. The coroner finds a scrape underneath her arm, like she was blocking something, and a bullet wound inside of her rib cage. It was a 38 that shot her, went all the way through her chest, and killed her slowly. Now, here's a couple of things that we do know. Somebody picked her up and drove her away. So, Webby, you might want to just lower that camera a little bit. Somebody drove her away. That means that the shooter escaped. We don't know who he is at all. There's no gunpowder residue on her body at all. This was not a close shot. All of her jewelry and cash were intact. She was not robbed. This woman is 64 years old. I want to believe this was their second marriage for her, so that, hey baby, where you been all my life, makes sense to me. She also is from Detroit, Michigan, which means she's from the North. She married into a very Southern prominent family, and that Southern family member died, which means the Northerner got her money. I'm giving you my perspective of what happened. Can't prove any of it, I'm just getting your wheels spinning. Here's what's gonna happen. You guys are gonna come up with the questions on what to ask Mary, so that way Sue can hear her in her own ears. What would you ask her?
Who shot you?
Who shot you? Okay. What else? Keep you coming.
Where did it happen?
Where did it happen? We know that one. That's a good one. So that way we can verify. We know it happened 2 blocks from here. I can't remember the exact cross street, but it's definitely a meeting and something else.
Something she knew.
What's the motive? And then, by the way, I want to also point out Julian's question, was it somebody you knew? That's a yes-no question, but okay in this instance, because there's going to be an elaboration on the answer. No, I did not. Yes, I did. So in this instance, when we're looking for direct EVP, it's okay. Using radio chatter, not so okay, because everything can be counted as a yes-no because it's a simple syllable. So that's why I always say, in this instance, it's okay. Ask whatever you want to. What other questions would you want? Jamie, you got anything?
How old were you when you died?
We know that answer too, which is good. Something we can verify. She was 64, just so you know.
How much pain did she feel?
Unfinished business like she did as usual. She didn't feel that way. Now you guys are all asking me these questions and I'm proving a point. When you're speaking to a ghost, you don't need to walk into a room and come up with a plan with your other person and then go scream into the room where you think the ghost is haunting. She can hear us. Even though you're asking me, you're technically asking her. So if we get direct answers to your questions, hopefully it shows up here. Again, these were people. You have to remember. Now, a couple of things. You guys asked some really decent questions, so I'm pretty good with that. I'm going to tell you what we've caught so far, if you want to come up with more questions as I'm telling you this. This is the new space for this year, so I wanted something brand new we haven't done before, bought the voice recorder, and I came up with this whole story, and I'll tell you how I came up with it in a minute. But what we've caught so far was a help, help in the background, and it was heard in real time. So it was a rando Tuesday or Wednesday, completely quiet, no cars, and I sent somebody around the corner because this person said, I just heard a woman's voice. Looked over that way, looked this way, nobody around. A few weeks later, we have a help me, and I have fallen. Same thing. Heard it in real time, went back to the office, I verified it, and I also had the keyword of help, which means I can now analyze both helps from each EVP. It's the same person. I can tell that by looking at the audio waves from those particular EVPs, not to mention the tone of voice was the same as well. So very interesting piece on that. I have a few mumbles. I don't like to count those because I can't verify what was being said, and there was a lot of people talking at the same time. So it was just a very odd instance. Any other major questions before I tell you how this story actually came about? You had it and lost it?
Wait, she was pushed, right?
No.
Shot. If she's been hit, she said she got hit, right?
Yeah.
But maybe she doesn't know she was shot. She just feels something.
Right. She just feels
horrible.
Pain.
Wait, you said it happened from a distance, right? It had to have been.
There's theories about that maybe she had her own 38 and tripped on it and it was in her handbag and shot her that way. Therefore, the gunpowder residue would have went on the outside of the hole, which is inside of her handbag.
Huh, that's what I was confused about.
There's a lot of...
She got hit, but also shot. Also, I got
no.
A
wasn't hit me at all. Is turned. Obviously, it came up this way as a woman lying down, but I turned it so that way we can have a patient comparison. So, what we're about to do over there, we might still hear from Mary because we're going to be pretty close, right? Also, remember, like, there's other things that can happen during this whole session. Anybody else want to give this thing a crazy listen before we go blindfolded? Jeff wants to try it out, so go ahead and peel them off. It's
clear.
Cool.
You can't hear anything in there.
So, was she married?
She's a widow. Right.
Husband,
love. Oh, you can hear that.
Right? It's super loud. Lung. When you were talking
about the bullet.
Oh. I like that too. in about a minute or so and then pass it around if anybody else want to listen to this when we're done.
I'd be interested.
Oh, I thought you'd be jumping all over that. Amy wants to jump on board? Okay.
No, I've been listening in the headphones all night.
So. Fair. This is a totally different style of headphone, though, man.
Oh, I'm sure.
Yeah, it's like right there.
So my mother-in-law actually uses this to watch TV when she's visiting. So if I have a house full of people, she just points it at the soundbar and she's good to go.
I can see that.
Yeah, it's very
good. Because as we're talking, it's like I hear these noises.
All right, Jennifer, I'm pass it back anyways.
Does someone want to take this thing for a while? Jeffrey?
Who gets the money?
Yeah.
If she dies?
After she died.
Probably would have went to one of her daughters. I want to say she had two daughters.
Okay. Well, we still don't know what the motive would be.
If there was one. There's
could it
a lot
have
of
been
theories.
An accident? We talked been. About maybe.
Some people say, like, there was one story that actually said that somebody was shooting at the cats in the neighborhood.
A boy, perhaps.
With a .38? Like, that's a serious gun in 1933.
Yeah.
Like, it was normally only used by cops, like,
okay.
to be quite honest. Like,
okay.
it's a pretty rare gun back then.
Okay.
I don't know anything about firearms. I had to learn about this shit. Like, is .38 okay. a common thing? Would you be able to get it easily? I mean, apparently, it's a flat-foot gun only. Like, that's how it
okay.
ran. But, and first off, why would you be shooting at cats in the neighborhood with a .38? Like, wouldn't they explode? Like,
yeah.
that's serious. Like,
when they're trying to hunt for someone else for a gun,
y'all know about guns? Y'all know anything about .38?
You can hit the red button on that. We don't need to be recording your feet. Jeff, hit the red button on your screen.
I can see, I can hear and see. I'm capable.
Everybody's gonna have a role when we get over there. EMF meters, you kinda already know your deal. But please don't stand next to each other like what you guys were doing. Kind of separate off to the corners of the circle like what you are doing now. So the same thing goes with yours, Doug. In the event that I'm not getting answers from Dalton and little help that I have over there, Jeff, those answers will come up on our Ouija board device or from our word generator. So just kind of keep that in mind. If you guys get a word, just tell me the word. Keep it nice and simple. They're not going to be able to hear us. Keep your film on them directly. They're going to want to watch this shit later. The other two cameras, I want you guys to either keep it on them or just do standstill 360s. Okay, you guys are seeing my point on that? We have caught in apparitions and different things with both of your style of cameras, but with yours, it gives us the clearest picture. You're dormant again. Probably the reason why. We'll get you up and running again.
Just record all the time after the stories.
Oh, yeah. You can hit it now if you want to.
Okay.
The camera on the left? Yes. So here's how this goes. First time I came in here, this is the new spot for last year. I only had two people. I always start after Halloween, because obviously Halloween's my biggest time of the year, and it starts to slow down, and I get to experiment with things for January. Two people, everybody else canceled because it was cold as hell. I told the young lady with the spirit box, tell me whatever you hear because I don't even know who we're looking for. She read the year 1828, the name Henry. I was using Sherry's word list that night, because that's what happens when we have two people. I use a few things in my pockets, too. I had the name Tim. Behind me is a bust of Henry Timrod, who was born in 1828. It was like, okay, that was easy. Here's his story, very quick and short. The guy's a writer. He's sick through most of his life. Being born in 1828, he can go fight in the Civil War. And he's a Confederate. He's from South Carolina. He goes out to the battlefield. And Emily Dickinson, all the other great poets, like he's being put right up there with him now. His work is finally being recognized over the past 5 to 8 years. Anyway, moving forward, he's doing pretty well for himself, and he's writing all this poetry, he's being published. He has a son. The son's name is Willie. He was born on Christmas Eve, but he did die 9 months later. So in the last dead baby of the night, because it is our last story, I'm sorry, there was a lot of them. Anyway, very sad for him and his wife, Katie. They're mourning. Henry's not writing as much. He has another friend that he went to school with, another writer. His name is Paul Hamilton Haynes. He offers him his cottage in Columbia. He says, go get back on track, man. Leave your wife Katie behind to mourn with her parents that were here visiting. He goes off to that cottage, and that's where he wrote his last words. His last words were, beholder of brief mortality. Today's language translates to, dear person with a short life. And then he coughed, and it landed on the page in a bloodstain. He had tuberculosis. He died right there, age 38, and in pain. Perfect way for a writer to go, but there's more. They show this last page that he wrote at the Charleston Library Society every year on Halloween only. They call it the Blood Book. And the reason why is that blood stain looks like a man writing at his desk. It's very creepy. You have to be a member of the society to be able to go see it, but the internet's beautiful. I'm going to show you what the page looks like, and then we're going to go talk to them as if they're a ghost. I'll give them a few tips and tricks of what to expect. Just so you guys know, for the two gentlemen listening to the spirit boxes, they're not going to be able to hear any direction. They're going to need tapping direction. So what does that mean? If they're too loud, I'll need somebody nearby to tap them on the shoulder. So people tend to grow in volume as they do this because they can't hear everything else around them. When we're done, because we'll do this for 10 minutes, they'll get a tap on the leg. So whoever's closest by me, you guys are all family, I'll just pull one of you and say tap them on the leg and get them tapped out. I don't touch the people on the bench. Hopefully you guys appreciate that. Here is your blood book. We have gotten shapes from Webb's device that he's about to go through that have been in this shape. So very interesting pieces.
What is his name again?
This is Henry Timrod. So, and you'll have links to his work as well. Like his full published works are available online. So I give you guys that in your report. That's a link. But again, for me, this tells the whole damn story. Behold our brief mortality, cough, death. Like again, we started off with a nice easy football player, guys, and I made it a little bit darker. We're ending with a bloody death. We all agree with that. Again, this guy is also like he can be. It might take me a minute or two to get to the top. Reminder for all of the people in this group, not them. Dr. Ladd's house that he lived in is right around the corner. He loves to come through. I'm not telling them, so they're not looking for things relevant to the doctor. That's the whistling doctor from the alley. They might die. All right, you guys ready?
Yeah.
All right, let's do it. We gotta get Madison all fixed back up again. Thank you.
Love you.
Yeah. Get everyone in frame. I got everyone in frame.
You want everyone in frame.
Why wouldn't I?
going once for an image. What was that? The bigger part. Henry going twice for an image. Peel that thing off your face. I'm dying to know what the hell's in there. Camera's got hit.
I have no idea.